The world around us isn't flat. Planet Earth is a roughly spherical home to the unique element of life, including us humans. But on a more practical note, the Earth, in terms of surface, is not flat. There are mountains, rocks, cliffs, hills, among an assortment of features. All things that are a different level of terrain. But how do these features come to be? And what was there before? Some are born in fire, others in ice, and many in the substance crucial to life on Earth as we know it, water. Assuming you are under the Earth's gravitational field, the Earth moves below your feet. The tectonic plates we stand on are constantly moving. They may only be moving at a rate of a few centimeters per year, but they're moving. Mountains are some of the biggest and most evident of tectonic features. When two oceanic plates of similar density are pushed together, the plate of a slightly greater density is forced under the other in a process called subduction. In the case of an oceanic and continental plate, the much denser oceanic plate subducts under the much lighter continental plate. When the plate subducts into the hot mantle, it melts into a magma less dense than its surroundings. As a result of its density and buoyancy, the light magma rises and breaks through different types of material until it reaches the surface. If it manages to break through the surface without solidifying, a volcanic eruption occurs and a composite volcano forms. When a volcano erupts, pyroclastic flow, comprised of hot gas and debris, which can reach up to 800 degrees Celsius, engulf the area. After every eruption, lava and ash layer to begin the volcano's slow ascent to the monstrous body we see today. Even in the surrounding area, the layers of ash and lava can be evident. The lava that flows from composite volcanoes rarely gets far away due to its viscosity. It is thick as a result of its abundance of silicate materials. This type of lava is felsic, as opposed to its thinner counterpart, mafic. Not all mountains are composite volcanoes. When two continental plates converge, none of them are dense enough to completely submerge under the other. Although one does submerge, it does not subduct deep enough to melt. Instead, it pushes the other plate upwards, folding it. The result? Monumental mountains, including the biggest in the world, in the Himalayas. But why do plates converge or diverge? What forces are at play? These forces are convection currents. When material heats up, it rises, like in a hot air balloon. As material gets closer to the Earth's surface, it begins to cool and fall back to its original position. When this process is repeated, it forms a circle-like shape, and it is in the direction of the upper part of the convection current that the plate moves. Another form of uplift is the batholith. A large mass of igneous intrusive rock, meaning rock formed from magma below ground. It is forced upwards by tectonic uplift caused by the subduction of plates. The Stowamis Chief in British Columbia is one of many examples of a batholith. The Stowamis Chief rose from the uplift caused by the subduction of the Juan de Fuca plate under the North American plate. All throughout areas of subduction, volcanic activity shapes the terrain. This is why areas near subduction zones are usually full of varying terrain, while places like here are, well, flat. Volcanic and tectonic activity are not restricted to the large masses themselves. Within rock, dikes can form. A dike is when magma or sedimentary rock enters a crack in a large rock. In the case of a magmatic dike, magma enters a crack, then cools. The rock is often of different color and texture, as it is cooled at a different rate than the surrounding rock. Basalt is a rock that cools quickly when it hits the surface, unlike the surrounding granite. Basalt is the primary component of oceanic rock, while granite is the main component of continental rock. Since the granite cooled at a slower rate than the basalt, the granite has large crystals, while the basalt has few. Even more extreme is obsidian, which cools so rapidly that there are very few crystals, which gives it its uniformity, and by extension, its shine. Both are igneous rock, meaning they come from magma, albeit different types. When lava cools, it contracts. And when lava contracts, it can crack. This results in columnar jointing, a collection of polygonal columns. It appears to be made by humans, but it is a phenomenon of nature. This is because the stress which cracks the rock is equal on all sides. A circle would be ideal, except they do not tessellate, meaning there is leftover space. Hexagons are extremely common in columnar jointing, as they are the regular shape with the most amount of sides that can tessellate perfectly. This is why honeycombs are hexagonal. Due to the abundance of volcanic activity on the Pacific coast of North America, as well as the entire Pacific Ring of Fire, columnar jointing is plentiful. Just as tectonic and volcanic activity give birth to an assortment of features, ice makes its mark. During the last ice age, glaciers left their impact on much of the northern hemisphere. What is a glacier, and where do they come from? For a glacier to form in a particular region, there needs to be more snow fallen in a winter than snow melted in the summer. There has to be an annual net gain of snow. A snowflake is a roughly hexagonal shape, and a layer of fresh snow is roughly 90% air. After a few years of a net gain in snow, the snow becomes so densely packed that almost all of the air is expelled. The snowflakes lose their hexagonal shape and take on a rounded shape under the intense pressure. This granular and packed type of snow is called fern. After a few decades, centuries, or millennia, that glacier becomes very large. Glaciers aren't just snow, they're made of ice. Due to the intense pressure, the rounded snow grains melt ever so slightly and recrystallize to form glacial ice. This process could take tens or even hundreds of years. A glacier is not only interesting in itself, but also in its power. A glacier begins to move when it cannot handle its own weight. This is called internal deformation. Due to the intense pressure of the glacier and the heat of the earth, the bottom part of the glacier can melt. This meltwater acts as a lubricant, which enables the glacier to slide. This action is called basal sliding. Before a glacier travels through a valley, the valley has a V-shape, possibly with a river at the bottom. The spurs, which are ridges out of the side of the main mountain ridge, are interlocking, causing the valley to wind. After a glacier goes through a V-shaped valley, it truncates or cuts off the spurs, causing the valley to take on a U-shape. Glaciers can also combine. When a deeper glacier combines with a shallower one, the land below the shallower one becomes a hanging valley, a valley atop a cliff. But how do glaciers alter the terrain? How do they erode the ground? Abrasion is the rubbing of a glacier and the ground. This explains why striations, or large gouges on rock, occur. We can use this information to determine which way the glacier moved. Sapping is when water enters cracks and expands by 9%, causing rock to become dislodged. As the ice moves, it attaches itself to parts of the rock, dislodging it and ripping it away in a process called plucking. All of these pieces of rock and debris, called glacial till, are taken away. But where do they go? When a glacier moves, the glacial till tends to accumulate on the sides and at the front. When the glacier moves, a line of till is formed. These types of lines are moraine. Other features that can form are roche moutonnée, which are a gradual incline of rock in the direction of movement through sapping and abrasion while the end has been plucked away. A drumlin is essentially a cluster of gravel or rock with a gradual decline in the direction of the glacier. A craggentail is a strong area of rock that the glacier could not erode, with a gradual decline of typical softer material from the area. Erosion contains two components: the recently discussed transport of sediment and weathering, the breakdown of material. When a large mass of rock, like a batholith, is underground, it is under intense pressure. When the rock is uplifted, the pressure is released and flakes of rock can break off. This type of weathering is called exfoliation. Oxidation is when rust forms on rock as a result of the rock losing electrons. When water freezes, it expands by roughly 9%. Water can enter cracks in rocks and expand, causing the rock to crack. This process is frost action, or sapping when referring to glaciers. Trees are also powerful. Their roots can grow through rocks in a process called root action. The angle of a slope is also important in determining how susceptible the area is to a change in terrain. When sugar, sand, or some other granular material is poured all at once, it will continue to slide until a certain point. The angle at which it becomes stable is the angle of repose. The same could be said with large boulders. However, that angle is much steeper. If the angle is too steep for the type of material, it can be susceptible to more landslides or other mass wasting. High levels of precipitation in the area are also a likely cause of unstable slopes. If a tree has grown sideways, then made its way up, called geotropism, it is likely that the slope is either unstable or was unstable in the past. The more vegetation in an area, the more stable a slope tends to be. along with other factors. We cannot forget the substance crucial to our very existence. Water is not only a necessity to life as we know it, but to the way our landscape looks. In a large body of water, such as an ocean, the incoming wave is the swash, while the retreating wave is the backwash. The angle of the swash is rarely perpendicular to the shore, and is correlated to the direction of the wind. At the same time, the backwash always retreats at a 90 degree angle to the shore. Since water is a great carrier of sediment and debris, the debris follows the path of the water. This results in the phenomenon of longshore drift, in which sediment is transported along the shore. If the right conditions are met, this sediment can be deposited and build up in an area, forming a spit. If the spit connects the mainland to an island, it is a tombolo. On that tombolo, there can be glacial till, which shows just how interconnected this all is. A bay forms when rock that is relatively soft is eroded. Compared to the harder rock beside it, the softer rock erodes at a faster rate, which recedes the coastline. The parts which stick out at the ends of bays are headlands. Obviously, water is quite powerful. Another feature formed by it is a wave-cut platform. Between high and low tide, the forces of erosion wear away at a cliff. These forces are hydraulic action, the force of crashing water, corrosion, a chemical imbalance in the water, attrition, the striking of materials, and abrasion, the rubbing of materials. Together, these forces cut a notch into the cliff, fittingly called a wave-cut notch. Eventually, as the notch grows deeper and deeper, the upper part of the cliff cannot support itself and collapses into the sea. The result, a platform of rock at roughly the level of low tide. Ultimately, we have forces pushing things upwards, creating majestic formations. And we have other forces eroding them away. This is conclusively why the Earth is not and cannot be smooth. And until next time, thanks for watching.